are once again at the Fanish Inquisition at WesterCon 70 in Tempe, Arizona. And this is an opportunity to ask questions of, in this case, seated WesterCons. The seated WesterCon after this one is WesterCon 71 in Denver, Colorado. And I'd like to ask the representatives from WesterCon 71 to come up here, and then you might have a presentation, and then we'll have questions.
We have a presentation on the theory that we might have had a projector. We don't. If anyone wants to see it afterward, just come bug us. We'll gladly show it to you.
And feel free to come sit up close if you want to have a better
view. Tonight.
I can see from here.
We'll get to that. Let's get that to you later. Give it a chance. Let's have a chance to do your presentation first, and then we'll take questions.
So we're going to actually use this as a sort of guide of what we want to tell you about, and then Q&A at the end if we haven't covered it by then.
Right.
So welcome.
So WesterCon 71 is in Denver, Colorado. It is, so 4th of July, as I mentioned during WesterCon 70's presentation, does start on, 4th of July is on a Wednesday, which is so much fun when you're planning a convention. So, because which weekend do you choose? So we chose the weekend after 4th of July for the bulk of the programming. However, because 4th of July is on a Wednesday, we are having some light programming that evening. We're calling that day zero. Well, there'll be some excursions. It's an opportunity to get into town, start to get acclimated, come see the hotel, come spend some time with us. And then the hotel that we're going to be at, and we'll go over that in a moment, has on the top floor, I believe it's the 12th floor, has an entire like windowed area. It's gorgeous, and we'll be able to watch the fireworks from up there. So we have that space, well, we have the space the entire time, but we have it that night as well, so we'll be able to do some fireworks, and depending on how membership sales go and stuff, we'll try and bring in some catering if possible. So make it into a real fun event for those people who are able to come and join us on the 4th of July night. And then the content will start on July 5th, which is the Thursday. So we run Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, so 5th through the 8th. And we will be starting programming probably around noon on that Thursday. So if you are a program-heavy person like myself, or you love to go see a lot of things, definitely plan to come into town if you get the time off, because we're going to have a lot of great stuff. We've got some great people in town. So that'll be the actual convention itself. And I don't know if you can see, but we did a couple maps. Are these on other pages, or this young page?
This is the page. Well,
all right. So people were questioning about how to get from the from the airport to the hotel. So there's the previous hotel we were going to be at, and we'll go over that in a minute, was going to have a light rail station that was supposed to be right by the hotel. That's not going to be done in time. Thankfully, this one's already built. So leave the airport, you're going to take one of the lines, and this is all on our website, but we did it in purple. You can see this is the one line you'll take to here. You'll switch to another line, which goes right here, and it is about 0.7 or 0.5 walking from the hotel. And if you don't want to walk it, the hotel has a shuttle that will do anything within 5 miles of the hotel. So we can actually coordinate with them to have them run a shuttle, you know, when we know there are people coming in that want to do that.
As the resident transit geek, I want to make sure I understand that right. The connection from the airport is a heavy rail, commuter-type rail operation that takes you to downtown.
It is like that.
The heavy rail train.
It's
a train as opposed to a tram with an overhead electric wire coming from the airport, and then there you change at the transit center to a light rail train that takes you to the airport.
It's actually technically a light rail that does have the electric over.
Oh, then they've done some new changes to the airport since the last time I was there. Okay,
it's neat. But because it is the one coming directly from the airport, it has luggage racks.
So
it has really great seating, and has seating both directions with luggage racks and luggage along the side, so you feel like you're kind of on the Hogwarts train.
Right.
Now, if you really like staying downtown, you can go all the way into downtown and switch to a light rail that comes to the hotel.
Okay.
If you're just looking to get to the hotel, you can jump off that one early to a different line, take a 20-minute longer trip.
All right.
Yeah. And then this is the view from the hotel. I don't know if you can see very well from there, but skyline, mountains, and the hotel is in an area called the Denver Tech Center, which is just slightly south of downtown. It's basically downtown was getting pricey, and so a lot of the IT companies, this is like 20, 30 years ago, basically said, let's go somewhere where there's more land and it's cheaper. So they moved south, and so it's grown into its whole area, but it's still in Denver.
Yeah.
It's actually a Denver address.
Some people will call it the Silicon Mountain instead of Silicon Valley. It's silly.
So speaking of the new hotel, so we were going to be at a hotel in Westminster, which is like a suburb of Denver. Their management changed and their ownership changed. And so when we were saying, oh, hey, there's some things going on our end, because our nonprofit changed as well around the same time. And So we were having conversations, and they said, oh, this thing about food, and this thing about con suites, and this, you know, all these things
room
were
parties.
Like room parties. And we're like, yes, those are very important to us, and they're an essential part of WesterCon. And they said, we can't do that. And we said, well, we can't hold a WesterCon at a hotel that can't do that. So thankfully, we had a relationship already with the Hyatt Regency, and everything has been great. We've been able to move to there, and the Hyatt Regency, it is used regularly for a lot of other conventions. If you've ever been to Denver for Mile High Con, another sci-fi, fantasy, literary convention, they've been there for, gosh, 5, 10 years, something like that. No, it hasn't been 10. So, and then another, there was a steampunk convention that has been there for like the last 4 years. So they are used to conventions, they're used to people dressing up, they're used to room parties, they're used to con suites. They've been very easy to work with.
And it also brought the room price down to $99
yes.
from $119, so we're very happy about that as well.
So, oh, and as it says on there, you have access to Denver Downtown. So I know a lot of people came to WorldCon in Denver in 2008, and we're really excited about, oh, are you going to be downtown? We're not going to be downtown. Downtown's very expensive. You don't want us to be downtown because there isn't a convention space in a hotel that you could get into for probably under $200 a night. So it'd be silly. But you can get the light rail station just around the corner, hop and take that directly to downtown. There's actually multiple lines that run directly into downtown from there. So you've got easy access to go downtown if that's something that's really exciting for you. Inside the hotel, if you're a map geek like we are, this is the, sorry, I'll try to stand still.
Move over that. If you're going to go
okay.
ahead and hold it up, that way you're still in the focus point of the
okay.
camera.
I
don't
know what to do.
You're why we're all here.
So
hang on a moment here.
Okay. So
put it back down on the table is what you're
okay.
saying because the camera's
okay.
actually focused on it so it can be recorded
okay.
as well. You'll do all right. All right. Yeah, no, you can stand there and point at it. That's fine.
All right. So when you walk into the hotel, there's a grand staircase that goes up and a big glass elevator so that if you're coming in the front door, that's what you're going to see. And then there's a little set of stairs that go down. And a ramp, and a nice ramp that kind of goes around and takes you right into the middle of it. So as you go upstairs, and then there's elevators that take you to the upstairs, and a ramp to take you to the downstairs. So that's the conference space, it's right there. So on the grand floor is where you have all the large conference rooms. That's where things like vendor room, art show, and there's a couple of rooms up here. So that's going to be on the upstairs area, and then the downstairs area is where you have all the small panel rooms. And they're all together, all centralized right through here. So you have panels rooms all along here. Right across, there's a theater style room. And right across, there's a couple of boardrooms. Restrooms are here, and restrooms are here. Hotel front desk is right here. So if you're checking in, you know, you can check in right there, and then just head on up. So that's kind of the internal layout of it. Some people have questions about what's nearby, where are the restaurants, where's that sort of thing. So this purple circle right here is around the Hyatt, around the hotel itself. And the closest one, the sandwich board, is 0.2 miles away. If you want to look, the furthest thing you see away from here is Great Northern, which is down here. That is 0.7 miles away. Right across the street here, there's a bunch of things like Qdoba and a really great pancake place. I mean, like gourmet pancakes.
And it's important to note that I was grabbing this off of Google Maps, and they will only show so many at a certain zoom level. There is more than just those dots. That's just all of them agree to show me in that particular view. So it's a heavy, the Denver Tech Center has a lot of businesses there. There's a lot of restaurants to serve those customers.
Yeah, because again, yeah, it's a lot of IT folks, and so at lunch, at rest, you know, they just have time to get out, get their lunch, but they have the income to do so, so there's a lot of restaurants that are populated right around there. Also right near there is another large hotel that hosts a lot of larger conventions like Starfest, which is like in the 5 to 7,000 people range of times. So they are very used to having conventions come and feeding lots of people. And again, the hotel will do the shuttle within 5 miles, anything around within 5 miles. So if you want to go to something and you don't want to walk it, feel free. But there is a really nice path that runs along here and takes you right onto here, and you can go around here.
It's a very pedestrian friendly neighborhood.
Yeah, I don't walk a lot because my feet hurt. I went and walked out that and was able to go to, I can't remember where Nancy and I went, but it was just grab like, you know, bowls of rice and Mexican food and stuff and walked back, and I had no problem. So if I'm your canary in the coal mine, there you go. All right, some surrounding grocery areas. Some people like to run out and grab some groceries. There's a King Supers up here.
Sorry, that one.
Oh, sorry. Oh, and then there's a Safeway up here on
yeah, King Sippers, Target, Walmart, whatever you're looking for, it's all within a 5 mile radius.
5 miles.
It's within 5 miles.
That's what happened, within five.
Yeah. The ones on this map are 1 to 2 miles away.
Okay.
If you
can't see it or something you want, that's fine.
Here, I'll pull up.
Don't worry about it.
we'll show you the presentation if you want.
No, it's more in case sometimes I'm repeating things because I'm heading it right at that microphone over there. I've had to work with
Thank
this
you.
Camera before.
And then there's some other attractions in the metro area that people have asked about. Wings Over the Rockies is a really cool air and space museum. They often do a lot of stuff with the local Star Wars groups, and they have actually an X-Wing, I believe, that lives at the hangar full time. Yeah, that's really cool. I don't think they're doing anything that weekend, so it would just be regular museum prices.
But it's still pretty awesome.
It's still really awesome. Other attractions, the 16th Street Mall, which is downtown, as some of you may have seen, it is even bigger and bolder than it was during WorldCon.
There's a free shuttle that runs up and down the street, so you can see all the attractions, but if you're not a heavy walker, you can still see it all without stressing yourself out.
Does the airline go from the hotel to the street?
It does,
The question was whether the light rail line near there goes to downtown.
Correct, yes. So, yes, and actually there's two options because the light rail runs, because there's multiple lines, and so if this is downtown, there's one line that runs down to like 16th and California, just kind of in the middle, and then there's another line that runs up to the top, and both of those connect to the shuttle. In fact, the shuttle runs all the way from up here to about down here to City Center Park. So you've got options depending on where you're trying to hit in downtown. Coors Field, some people want to go and see a baseball game. We don't have the Rockies schedule yet, but that's another thing that people enjoy doing. And they have a great fireworks display also if they're home on the 4th. Red Rocks Amphitheater, if you love to hike, if you are an athletic person, drink a lot of water first, make sure you're acclimated. We don't want anybody passing out. But Red Rocks has some amazing hiking areas, and people go jogging there, and I mean, it's insane. And you can see really cool concerts.
Concert venue.
Yes, it's a great concert venue. When it's not showing concerts, people are crazy. They're like walking all over the place. Sorry.
There's regular early morning exercise groups that do like running up and down the stairs. It's a lot.
And they do like the, you know, step walk, step walk. I just like their Facebook posts. people were concerned at the Spanish Inquisition about how will myths and legends, I run an annual event called Myths and Legends Convention. It's usually in August. And when we got the WesterCon, the intention was that we were going to co-host those together. So people are asking about, are we combining conventions for that year? Yes, we are combining conventions. So how will that affect WesterCon? How will WesterCon affect Myths and Legends Con? And the really cool thing is there's a lot of overlap. Myths and Legends focuses on a few fandoms but it's always on the literary side of things. So we're talking Harry Potter, we're talking Lord of the Rings. We also do Doctor Who. There's a lot of really cool tie-ins with books and comics and on that as well. And Firefly, again, there's been some really great backstories that have been done in literary with that. And plus, we just love those fandoms. So. We have definitely focused on a lot of that stuff, so it is a literary and sci-fi focus for Myths and Legends, same as WesterCon, right? We have art show, vendor, these are things where we overlap a lot. Fan tables and author readings, our authors love to talk. So we definitely have...
That's so weird.
Right? Some things we do with Myths and Legends, how much time do I have?
I'd give it a couple more minutes.
Okay.
We're almost at the end of the
Yeah,
we're almost at the end.
Questions.
Things we do at Myths and Legends that we've seen more of at WesterCons recently, we do tea dueling. People love, it's fun, y'all just see it. We do a lot of make and takes, because people really, and I'm not talking about just children, I mean, I'm talking for the adults. He hosts a chainmail panel that we've done every year, this is coming up on our 5th year, and I've had to give him bigger and bigger rooms. Because there's people who really love making chainmail, being able to take that.
I keep buying more pliers, and I keep running out of them during the sessions.
We have a knitting circle that we it's an area where you can drop in and just have a place to hang out with other crafters. Fairies. We have a strong fairy collection in Denver, and so they also have a treasure hunt kind of fairy. I'm not describing it well. You get a little fairy bag of trinkets. Some of us call it junk, and you basically go, hey, I will trade you my 5 buttons if I can have your four strings of beads. You're like, sweet, I'm collecting buttons, cool, I'm collecting beads. And then you just kind of trade, and it's a great way to mix and mingle with people throughout the convention. And at the end, there's silly prizes. And then we also do things that are like blanket forts, because we kind of like to enjoy finding, connecting with the inner child and ourselves, all those things that you didn't get to do when you were a kid, or you did and you loved it, and now you get to do it as an adult. So we have actual blanket fort adult-only sessions, because the adults were getting pushed out by the kids. So we fixed that. WesterCon has some traditions that we will be bringing in, though, of course, like the ice cream social. We love that. Room bid parties are not so big at our Myths and Legends, but they're so much fun here. Vanish Inquisition, we'll definitely bring that in. And the formal dances. We don't have formal dances, so we'll definitely be including that in our WesterCon. So I'm really excited about that, actually. We want to do more dancing. Charity Garden, I mentioned it briefly. So our nonprofit was a different organization. That organization is dissolving. Thankfully, Shiny Garden is a nonprofit that has taken over the running of my Myths and Legends convention, and also is running two other conventions as well in the Denver metro area. And very focused on bringing in diversity into our fandom community and into our fandom events. Sorry, I use the word fandom a lot. That's kind of the key word in Denver. But fanish, you could intermix. Fanish for a lot of the old guard, fandom for a lot of the Denver crowd. We're talking pretty much the same language there. So Shiny Garden, that is our goal, is to bring more diversity and help with issues of people not feeling represented, and also help with the issue of the graying of the fandom that is pervasive. So Shiny Garden is now running both the Myths and Legends Convention and will be taking over WesterCon. So it's all under one roof for 2018.
And as treasurer, there's just no telling you how much better that makes my life.
One line item.
So much easier.
So we do offer passes through Con or Bust for Myths and Legends, for WesterCon, for all of our events. I know that was a question that came up a number of times over the last few years. They're an organization that provides passes at no cost to people of color who want to attend and can't afford it, because there's socioeconomic issues that are pervasive throughout society. So that is something that we try to help out with. So we also are offering some membership scholarships to our events. Connor Bus is one of those options. People were asking about, hey, it's Denver, ganja. Not so much. Yes, pot is legal. However, there are boundaries and laws. Some common things you are not allowed to do. You're not allowed to smoke in public. That includes marijuana, that includes cigarettes, that includes vaping in some regards, because vaping is still new enough. They're still working on the laws on that. But basically, consider that if you are a smoker of any point, of any part, you need to find a private place to do that.
Hotels are not private.
Hotels are not private. Your car is not technically private if you're out on the out and about. A park is not private. No, back behind the building is not private. So if you are going to imbibe, and I totally understand if you want to come to Denver where it's legal and check it out, find somebody to kind of walk you through that. Do not go buy a brownie the whole thing. Do not go and buy a bunch of pot and roll it up and smoke the whole thing. Find a babysitter, basically, is what I'm saying. And try to be a responsible adult, because we don't want anybody getting themselves in a situation where they are not comfortable and not happy with the experience that they're having. And then we're having a room party. Yay! That was crazy. That's tonight and upstairs on the fourth floor, 469 in the corner, and we are happy to answer any questions. Billy will be set up with the laptop and the membership forms.
Definitely.
We would love to have you guys come to Denver. We think Denver's pretty awesome, even if it's hugely expensive right now.
Let me try a few of them that I think have come up before. First of all, can you generally, I know you can't predict it, can you generally describe what we could expect the weather to be like that weekend in the Denver area?
So global warming has actually affected us, I think. So we have been hitting 30 recently, Celsius.
Celsius.
Which is?
Fahrenheit 90s.
Yeah, we hit 90s a bunch of times already in June this year, which is really unusual. Usually it would be like in the 80s in June, and you'd get into like the 90s in July, and hit maybe 100 once or twice in July and August.
But then again, it was down in the 70s when we were leaving,
it's supposed to hit 113 out here.
That's not going to happen in Denver. Okay.
Not next year. So description of warm and dry, but not as hot as it is here in Tempe.
Correct.
Well, she's comfortable.
So one of the big things in Denver is there's a lot less air between you and the sun. So if you are in direct sunlight, you are going to feel it a little bit more. If you're in shade, though, it tends to feel a lot cooler than it's going to be in a place like Tempe or Texas or whatever.
Yeah, and the temperature variety every day is about 20 to 30 degrees of a variance, so Fahrenheit. So if it's 90 or 95, hopefully we don't get that hot. But if it's like, say, you know, 90 at our peak, it'll probably get into the high 60s overnight. So you just open up all your windows and air it all out, and then it's nice and cool again. And then we have air conditioning. You know, the hotel has air conditioning. It's great, and they just renovated.
Is it over air conditioned?
Yeah,
hopefully not this cold.
A variance of 30 degrees Celsius would be.
Oh my gosh.
So
not going there.
I think you covered it, Anna. The next question I have here, what is the parking situation like at your facility? Is it paid?
They have the only parking garage in the Denver Tech Center.
So it's there's a parking garage. Is there a flat parking lot for overnight vehicles?
It's a $5 fee come and go throughout the whole weekend.
Yes.
$5 a day or $5 for the week? So it's a $5 fee flat with in and out privileges.
There are some service level parking spaces as well, especially some handicap spaces by the side of the building for those people who just don't want to use the parking garage.
Well, I'm thinking if there are some people driving vehicles that simply won't fit into a parking garage, and I don't even necessarily mean motorhomes, but I mean overheight, full size vans, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
It does have a pretty high entryway, but will you make a note? We need to we'll check with the hotel on what, how
dealing
do they handle
with overheight and oversized vehicles. There's usually a small number of them.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sometimes it's been us. But yeah.
Okay.
Linda.
Yeah, that's a great question.
Can you remind me again who the guests of honor are?
Oh, yes, the guests of honor.
Yes, let me grab a postcard. Okay, so we have Nancy Kress is our author guest of honor. Jeff Sturgeon is our artist guest of honor, and he did the lovely
Seattle people
art on here. Well, we're trying to throw the reach out because there's some really cool people out, and Denver people don't necessarily get to see them. Rebecca Mesta is our editor guest of honor, which I'm really excited about because she's so adorable. And because she's married to Kevin J. Anderson, usually she kind of gets overshadowed by Kevin being a guest. And so we're really excited that we have Rebecca coming as a guest. I've told her I want her to talk at panels. She's a little nervous, but she'll be great. She'll be great. Margaret Davis and Christoph Clover are our Filk guests of honor. Yeah, really excited about them. And the people who were part of the Denver WorldCon, Mem Morgan and Kent Bloom, are our fan guests of honor. And they still run Cosine every year down in Colorado Springs. And then our master of ceremonies is David Gerald.
Yay!
Yes, he's a delight. So did I miss? We have a magician.
Andrew Mann, I believe, is our. We're having trouble naming him, but entertainment/magician.
Special guest.
I think I haven't missed anybody. So
yeah.
And please feel free to come get postcards. This is Jeff Sturgeon's art on here, our artist guest of honor. So please definitely take that home, frame it.
All right, you have a question.
I was wondering the approximate size of Myths and Legends in the last few years.
Oh, sure.
The size of the convention.
Of Myths and Legends convention.
Of Myths and Legends, yeah.
Sure. Last year, now I include all heads, including attendees, vendors, and volunteers, because we all buy stuff, and vendors are usually ones who want to know. So we were about 725 last year. We keep it small. People really like that small convention feel, that more intimate.
That being said, Miss Legends has been steadily growing at 10 to 20% over the last couple of years. So it's come up to around 700 people in the building from its origin of about 400 people in the building.
What's pre-reg up to now?
Pre-registered membership for your WesterCon as it stands now.
Sure. Miss Legends Con is normally about $45 at the door, and we figured because there was an extra day in there, we would go ahead and just adjust the prices accordingly.
WesterCon.
How many members do you have pre-registered so far?
How many pre-registered? Not the cost.
How many members do you have at the moment?
Signed up to attend the convention.
That's an excellent question.
Let me have my treasurer take a look at that
right away, I guess.
I thought you were asking how much membership
would it cost?
Because attending membership is 60.
My apologies.
Yes.
Your altitude?
It's about 5280 because we're Denver. It's about 5300 there, I think. So yes, I mean altitude is definitely something which is another reason why I want to encourage people to come in on the 4th, because that gives you an extra day of drinking water and
acclimating
a little bit. And I do encourage people to please take it easy. Don't plan to come to Denver run a marathon, but definitely come and enjoy it. And that's one of the great things I love about this hotel is things are reasonably close together. Even if it's on two floors, they're one right above each other. So you're not gonna, oh, but we don't have pictures of the top floor on there. Yeah. And then there's the top floor, but you take the elevator to get there.
I have a resilient pictures. I'll probably make a gallery at some point.
You have the approximate
Is the size of the hotel about the size of this hotel?
What is the size of this hotel, actually? I haven't been able to kind of get a good grasp on it.
Well, there's the two buildings with the courtyard in between. Just give me an idea whether I really need to rent a scooter in Denver.
To get from panel rooms to the ballroom, for instance, maybe 50 feet to the elevator up, and then another 50. It's not a lot,
okay. But
if you're trying to move from a ballroom to a panel room to a ballroom to a panel room because they're on the separate floors, that may get a little more taxing than if you're one of the.
You don't have to go around in a big square.
You don't.
Yeah.
That may be a little more taxing than if you're just like, I'm in panel rooms all day because I love this stuff. Ah, main events, who cares? So it's kind of up to you.
You were able to find the membership count?
So to answer your question, we currently have 108 attending members and 32 supporting members. And that's predominantly from the WesterCon crowd because a lot of the Myths and Legends regular attendees don't purchase for 1 year until they're at, don't purchase for 2018 until they're at 2017.
Right.
That's coming in 4 weeks, so we're expecting to see a bump in that number
at
that event. Lisa, you had a question?
I have a question as a point of culture. And you used the phrase pass once before. The first Denver people continue to use the word ticket. This is a cultural point.
Yes.
If I am purchasing a ticket, I am not bringing my equipment, I'm asking you what you're doing for me. I'm as a member, I'm coming to help be a member. Have you done anything to adjust this cultural point with your people? I, for one, do not want to go to a ticketed event.
I understand. So everything on our website you'll see has membership, or it'll say passes, or it'll say badges. But we are definitely, you know, encouraging the membership thing, usage of that word.
We do have a technical issue where it is difficult to find a website that will vend passes, memberships, etc., without using the word ticket. We have moved away from a website called Brown Paper Tickets towards a facility through our nonprofit database called Boomerang. And they still use the word ticket, which is frustrating. I reached out to their customer support and they said there wasn't anything they could do about it right now. So even there on the registration website, it's very difficult to get away from that word, and we are trying to.
The culture of it, though, pervades the first group who brought this forward and did not understand what a membership was.
Yes.
Right, yeah.
We are very pleased with the concept of membership because it really does fit our model of our community that we're building in Denver. Denver fandom does tend to use words like ticket or badge, and we try to be very cognizant that that doesn't really capture what a lot of WesterCon attendees and members feel like it should. It is a pervasive issue.
Amusingly, with the gaming convention that we are running in January, we're able to get away from that because you purchase a badge to attend and you purchase tickets to individual items. So that seems to be the only place where they are in line word-wise with what we're trying to do.
Well, with regards to the verbiage.
Correct, yes.
Does the Myth and Legends fandom consider themselves participants or audience?
Participants.
Because I think that's the disconnect.
Yeah.
Sure, no, definitely participants. It's a very kind of community feel to it. When people come, they are very much like, oh, this is my home. And I'm a part of this event.
And when you look at the programming, a lot of the panels are much more geared toward, let's all get together and talk about this thing. Let's talk about why this is so awesome, or why this is so controversial, or what's important about this. And a lot less, let's sit and listen to people talk to us for 45 minutes.
It doesn't matter what the words are, it's the
feeling. There's a mix and match. There are a few of those. We have some really cool people and we want you to listen to them. But there's a lot of, let's all talk together, or let's all get together and make some chain mail.
Okay. We would like to go ahead and wind this up. Are there any more questions? And if not, I'd like to. You do have a table down at the Fantails area. You have a party tonight, and buy your memberships and join WesterCon next year. And I want to thank you very much for your time. And that's it for the Fantasy Inquisition.
Thanks for that.